United States Monetary History, Chapter 3, Land Banks and Speculation. In the prior chapter, the Massachusetts government issued the first government fiat paper money seen in the Western world. The infection would spread to the rest of the colonies and the effects along with it. The land banks would be short-lived and add to the culminating failure. When we last left the Massachusetts government, they just returned from another failed raid to Quebec in 1711. Unable to pay their debt and finance the raid, they created another 500,000 pounds of paper money. This was used to finance the shortfalls and pay the soldiers. This drove out all the remaining silver Spanish dollars that were used in circulation prior. In response to the newly created shortage of money, the creation of a land bank by the Massachusetts government would attempt to increase the currency in circulation. It would open its doors and create 100,000 pounds in notes. They would begin issuing out for loans on real estate in various parts of the colony. This furthered inflation and speculation, and the notes would fall in value at a rapid rate. The 13 colonies had varying success with land banks. In the colonies where agriculture was highly profitable, the underlying value of the land was much higher and the banks tended to thrive, with the exception of the Carolinas. Oddly enough, the Carolinas had become a refuge for English debtors' prison in 1732, around the same time that the land banks would begin opening their doors. This higher value in land meant that the middle colonies found more success than the northern ones did. Notes for the land bank were issued against the land owned. This is similar to taking out a second mortgage on a property. The overall success of the land banks and the value of the notes would depend on the number of notes in circulation, how valuable the land in the region was, if it was acceptable by the government as taxes, and favorable terms of redemption on the notes. In the middle colonies, where the notes value was higher because of the better quality of land, the notes value was generally stable. Issues of notes by the land banks in this area did not dwarf the supply of specie in these colonies. Along with the government not printing their own fiat paper money, or only in small amounts and for short periods of time to finance military operations, this allowed these areas to use the system mostly unscathed from its negative effects. However, in the New England colonies, many of the banks issued too many notes to make up for the less than favorable land. The governments compounded this problem by printing large amounts of fiat money when new debts came due. These areas would see a disappearance of specie, thus diminishing the money supply further, requiring more notes to be issued, compounding the problem. Between 1710 and 1740, each of the colonies would begin issuing their own fiat currencies, with the exception of the Virginia government, with similar results in each colony. Later studies would show that this paper money would create rather predictable boom and bust cycles. When the paper money was injected into the colonies, a boom would occur, to be followed by a deflationary period when the money supply contracted. As a result from the inflation of printing fiat paper money across the colonies, prices had risen nearly twice what they had been 20 years earlier. This turned the public opinion against paper money in the areas most affected. The paper money, in accordance with Gresham's law, would drive out the silver dollars, the good money, into hoards, creating a boom-bust cycle, increasing speculation, rising prices, and nominal units of account, transfer government debts to those holding the currencies through the tax of inflation, and the worst of all, this instability would stall trade, and long-term plans for expansion would grow shorter and shorter, and exchange rates would complicate trade transactions. In 1748, after the war with France ended, Parliament pressured but not forced the colonies to retire their paper money and return to specie. The Virginia government would finally begin printing fiat paper currency for short periods of time to finance the French and Indian War that would break out in 1750 and would redeem them through taxes shortly thereafter. This war could arguably be the first true world war, as it was fought throughout Europe, Northern and Central America, and in many colonies across the globe, to include West Africa, India, and the Philippines. The fighting would include the kingdoms of Great Britain, Spain, and France, along with the empires of Russia, Mughal, and the German states. During this conflict, we would see similar alliances to those of World War I. To the rest of the world, this war would be known as the Seven Years' War. In 1751, shortly after hostilities broke out, the British government prohibited further issues of paper currency in the New England colonies and pressured a move towards redeeming all paper money. Many of the colonies would return to specie, and despite local governments' lack of power to tax with inflation, the colonies financed the fighting with the use of the available specie, proving that inflation is not necessary to fund wars. The conflict would end in 1763 with the Treaty of Paris. In 1764, the Parliament would no longer encourage the retirement of paper money and enforce it across the colonies. Rhode Island was the only colony that refused to move away from paper currency. Instead of the predictions that returning to specie would lead to an absence of money, and ruin of the economy, the hard money led to more stable trade and therefore more economic growth in the colonies that returned to specie. Rhode Island, due to their stubbornness, lost most of their thriving trade to Massachusetts. The prosperity that led up to the Revolution was largely due to Britain's intervention and not allowing the colonies to print more paper money. The colonies operated on a silver standard not set by institutions. This meant that no bank or government was setting the exchange rate of silver. As a result, the hard money stabilized exchange rates, led to an influx of specie to the colonies, did not cause a hard depression while returning to a full specie system. The stability advanced trade in the colonies that reduced and abolished their paper money, while those that did not lost market shares to those that did. Click here for the next video in U.S. monetary history, where the reasons to stay part of the British Empire would fade and the explosion of paper money would finance a war that was almost sure to fail. This has been Money Recall, and don't forget to like and subscribe.